Okay. Hello, everybody. Welcome to day two of Command Line Fundamentals. So today, will be me, Hui, and this is Javier, and here's Anthony. And we'll get started. So if you guys remember from yesterday, the focus of yesterday was really introducing the basics of Bash and the terminal. We wanted to show you guys how to move around in the directory, how to create new files, and also how to execute scripts. And the purpose of today is actually extending a little bit more into that.
Sorry, could you talk a bit louder?
Yeah, sure. To show some of the more perhaps advanced features of the terminal that you might find useful, whether that be in your Europe research project or internship. So we'll get started. First, I wanted to discuss the idea of the super user. So like in Windows, there is distinction between a normal user and administrator. In Linux, right, you have a normal user account and also the super user. Oftentimes, there are commands that you will need to run that require escalated privileges, such as those that install new packages, add or remove users, or edit system files. And so there are two main options for you. The first is, if you currently have a normal user and you know the credentials of either the root user or administrator user on your machine. So oftentimes we're dealing with either using your own personal machine or a server that you control. So this first command here, su space dash, it will log you in as the root user, which often has full system access on most Linux machine. Now, nowadays on most modern OSs, the root user is disabled. In that case, you may need to log in as an admin user, like su-admin1, if your username of your admin account is admin1. Now, if you're actually yourself an administrator account, you can do something like sudo space command. And this, what we'll do is execute the command with super user privilege. We'll ask you for your password, which you need to enter, and it will prompt you once for that entire shell, after which, when you run sudo again, it will just run fine without a password. So there are some security concerns with sudo. In cybersecurity, there is this concept called least privilege principle. And the idea is that users and programs should have the lowest privilege or permission level that they need to do their task. And so when running commands with sudo, right, they can be dangerous when you're executing something that could be irreversible. For example, yesterday, Anthony talked about sudo remove -rf slash. Now this command is essentially deletes all the files on your file system. And once you run that, there's really no easy way to get your files back. In addition, right, when you're running a script with sudo, you're essentially trusting that script to do whatever it wants to do. And so oftentimes, when you're running something like a program or a script, you want to look into the content, see what it's doing before actually running it. So overall, the rule of thumb is to just avoid using sudo where possible. Oftentimes, you don't need sudo for a command to run. And then when you do, you know, make sure that you trust it. OK, so one of the ways you can use sudo is with managing packages. On most operating systems, they will have different package managers that they use. And the role of package managers is that they allow you to, manage packages. So if you need to install like third-party software on your computer, you will use a package manager like apt on Ubuntu. And macOS, this is not installed by default, but they have Homebrew. Other package managers include Yum, Flatpak, Pacman, etc. And the use of package manager is that they make it easy for you to install software. Right, instead of going on Windows where you have to search a specific website, download it, go through like five different steps, to install it, you just run a command on these package managers. And most of these will obviously require root privileges. So just for example, the Ubuntu, you have sudo apt install for a package. You remove by sudo apt remove package name. And the updating process is similar on both Ubuntu and Mac, where you have to do first sudo apt update. Brew has this version of brew update. and then sudo app upgrade. And the distinction is that, like sudo app update, it actually updates the system package repository. So your computer has a way of managing, seeing like, what is the latest version of the software that I have? And over time, right, software will get a new version. So they will need to update this information before actually upgrading the software. So that's the difference between these two. And so yeah, similar for Mac, you have brew install, brew uninstall, brew update, brew upgrade. So they're pretty self-explanatory. Does anybody have any questions so far? Oh, and I forgot to mention, if you're on Zoom, feel free to put your question in the chat and we'll make sure it gets asked. Okay, we'll move on. So this is some example. Like I install VLC, which is a very common media player. I just do sudo app install VLC-y. And the dash y here just says yes. Sometimes it will prompt you like, do you want to actually install the software? This is how much space it will take. So I just added that flag there. Now this command I actually took from the Node.js website, but actually Anthony pointed out it's not such a great command. So here you're doing something called curl, right? It's essentially a way doing a terminal where you give it a link and you install, like download whatever package or software that is at that link. And here you're piping it, which we'll explain in a little bit, to sudo and then bash. So you're essentially trusting whatever the script is at this website here, saying, okay, pull it down from the internet and then run it. Usually you want to do this separate step, download it first, look at it, and then actually run it. But just a little interesting to know. Okay, similar to Python libraries, I won't talk too much about this, but you know, Python has its own package manager called pip. And you can install libraries or package with pip install and pip uninstall. If you have both Python 2 and Python 3, sometimes they're a little bit weird. So pip, I think by default, will tend to download Python 3 packages. And if you want to do Python 2, you have to run it with pip 2. But I've heard the better method is used for two environments. I'll encourage you to look a little bit more into that. Okay, so the second part I want to talk about is bash scripting. A lot of times when you're doing stuff on the terminal, you might find yourself, oh, I'm typing the same five commands or same set of commands over and over. So how do I actually automate that, right? And so bash nicely has its own kind of scripting language. So there are things you can do, right? Like defining a variable. So I'll say, name one equals my name. So you should note that like you don't put a space in between the variables. That's just how that bash likes it. And this is specifically to bash. I think Mac slightly had different syntax. And if you want to actually like get the value of that, you do something like name with this dollar sign in the front. Okay. Sometimes you can wrap string around it. And strings are actually interesting. If you do double quotes, it will like try to read, interpret what's inside, like if there's variable names and stuff. But if you do a single quote, it would actually be a literal string. So it will not try to interpret what's ever inside. So
for now. Can you explain what echo is?
Oh, yes, echo. So echo is a command that's just, it's the equivalent of print for other languages. Yeah. So let's pull back. So there's some things like for loops here. I'll show. So first, like let me show you something like a command like sequence from 1 to 5. And what it does is just gives you kind of essentially a list of the numbers 1 through 5, right? So if you want to do a for loop, you'd be like for value in sequence 1 through 5. And this dollar sign parentheses essentially tell you execute this thing first. Right, it will say, okay, for loop do. I say, let's say make directory value, right? So what do you think this does? Done. Anybody have any ideas? So, right, you're giving
this directory with
name value and inside the directory as that sequence?
Yeah, very close. So let me do ls. You can see that we created five directories with the name 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah. So you're just using the value here as like the name of the folder you want to create. Similarly, like, okay, I want to another way you can do like search directory, just a variable I create, and I say dot. So that's the current directory. Before entry in search directory. And then this backslash star here is just a way of in file path. This is how you say, I want to get everything inside this folder. And I think Javier will cover more into that. So do echo entry. Done. And what this will do is actually print out all the files in the current directory. So, you know, there are easier commands to do this, but you can see how this could be useful if you want to automate, like, let me go into this folder, get everything, and do something with it. Delete it, remove it, edit it, stuff like that. Similar, if else has a similar thing. So I think an interesting thing to show is this. So what this is saying is actually a Boolean expression. It's saying if this thing in here is true, and here I'm calling an environmental variable called UID. And sometimes if you don't understand a variable, just look it up, right? UID here, I think, defines like the system ID of the current user. And 0 means that it has a root access. Say, then, echo your root. Else, you are not root. And then phi, opposite of if. And so it will see that you are not root. And if you were confused about the UID, so environmental variables are just like variables that are automatically loaded in when you go on the terminal. So for example, if I type environmental, these are all the variables that, you know, it's loaded in right now. Yeah, and some of them is more useful than others, like pwd, it's your current directory, right? You guys remember pwd. So yeah. Does anybody have any questions so far? Okay, good. Okay, move on. All right. And then a little bit more thing is command aliases. So besides scripting, right, that's doing like mundane tasks that you need to do on over. You can also have shortened commands. Maybe you're tired of typing SSH and, you know, curb at athena.alab.mit.edu over and over and over. What you could do is you can do an alias, so just be a short name for it. So Ubuntu, you have something called a home directory .bashrc file. On Mac, you have something called .bash_profile. Sometimes you need to create these if they're not already created. But so I believe it should work here. So sorry. So these are like the script that's automatically executed at the beginning. Maybe I'll just add at the end. Okay. So like alias SSH. It wouldn't make more sense if I was doing it off my normal computer, but. So usually you have to reload your console to do that. So can I do it off this terminal here?
You can exit and SSH back in.
Okay. Okay. Second, sorry. So now if I do SSH MIT, see that it automatically tries to ask for my password. So right, instead of typing that home command, now you have something shorter. Other examples, right, like we just provided here is alias, like LSA. Sometimes you want to show hidden files, and instead of remembering what the flag is, well, it's part of the name, but LSA. You can also, if you do remove, sometimes you might want to look at what you're removing. So you do like remove dash I. And so aliasing that just makes it easier without the flag. Okay. So for this part, we'll move on to Javier. Oh, yes. Oh, sorry. Oh, do you have any questions? This one, okay.
Just like the permanent alliances. The permanent alliances. Maybe you could go over that again.
Right. Okay, yeah, so aliases are ways to shorten the command that you write, right? And so you can enter this alias, this command, like, into your terminal, but it only will be active for whenever you're on the terminal. So the reason why we add those commands into these files is so that every time you open up a terminal, it will automatically do that for you.
All right, just to add on for a little bit about aliases, sometimes like different operating systems are a little weird in that like it might not be bash or C, it might be like some other thing like shell, like the Z shell, as we saw like yesterday. We were having a problem with us having to like look into the Z shell, but that's stuff that you can look over online and stuff, that because different operating systems are different in some ways, but for the most part this should work, especially on like servers. So now moving on to grep and find, which are the main ways we can search in the terminal. For this, I'll do like a live demo. So essentially grep allows you to find text within a terminal, within a file, or many files. And what this means is like, let's say you have a function and you don't know where exactly it is in the file. You can just search up the name of the first part of the name of the function, and then you'll know which line in the file it is. So, for example, let's say we want to. Do you know where it is? Sorry. Okay, so like for example, here we have our Hamlet file, which is the entire series of Hamlet. And let's say we want to search for the word Hamlet. So we would do grep Hamlet, and then the name of the file, and then we click enter. And as we can see, here we have all the instances of Hamlet within the Hamlet book, which is like quite a lot, but like less than I would have expected, I guess. That's the main part for grep. There are like extra flags that you can look into, but for the most part, this is all you need to know for the basics. The next thing to know for searching is also find. And what find does is it allows you to look for files within a directory or a series of directories. So let's say you're trying to find out if you have Hamlet in your directory, but you don't really remember. So what you can do is find, and you need a flag for to use find, and the most common flag is name, for the name of the file. So you do dash name, and then you do hamlet.txt. And then as you can see, it shows up that it is in a directory, as seen by like the dot, which as we saw yesterday, means the first, it means our current directory. So Hamlet is in our current directory. Yeah, and one other thing to know about these two commands is you can like use an asterisk to sort of autocomplete, like search wider in a way. So if you want to do, for example, grep Hamlet asterisk, that'll search up for Hamlet and all the files in your current directory. So in this case, it's only since Hamlet is only inside the Hamlet text. That'll be the only file that's within. There's also other cool ways to use the asterisk in that Let's say you do ls and you have all these files, and let's say you want to see all the files that end in .txt, so you can do ls *.txt, and the asterisk will sort of like say, okay, anything that your file can start with anything, but it has to end in .txt. So then you press enter, and you can see we have two files that end in .txt. So those are useful things to know. The next thing to know is, the next thing we'll cover is extracting information from files. And there are two main ways, which are sed and awk. So sed is what's called a stream editor, and that it takes in a file, and then you can manipulate the data, like the words in the file, and then output them in a way. But it'll only do that, it'll only output it. So unless you specify the dash I flag, it won't actually edit the file. So this is useful, like if you want to just test out some things but not actually edit the file, you can just do that. And then if you want to actually edit it, you would just use the dash I flag. So what I mean by editing is like you would search for patterns within the file and then do something to those patterns. So for example, if we just view the example file we have here, we see it's just a 3x3 ABC. But let's say we want to turn all those A's into capital A. So what we do is sed S means like search, and then A for the letter we're looking for, and then capital A, the one we want to replace it with. And then we end it like that. And the file name, which is this example. I forgot the slash at the end, which is wrong on the slides, but I'll correct it later. So once you have that, as you can see, like A is swapped with the capital A, but as you can see, like it's only on the first A in each line, and that's by default. But if you want to change every single A, you can just add to the command slash G. And what that does, well, I guess you don't need a. What that does is replace all A's within the file to a capital. And then similarly, like you can concatenate a bunch of these. So you can do S slash B slash capital B slash G. And now both A and B are capitalized. So overall, like these are like a toy example, but like if you had like words you wanted to replace with like their uppercase version, or like just delete them entirely, like there are ways to manipulate the words like that. And then of course, if you want to just make this permanent, you add dash I. And then if we cat into the example, now it's permanent. And every time, now when you go back to the file, it'll be like this. So yeah, that's sed. And then when it comes to awk, it's a little similar, but it's also kind of more unique because awk depends on, I guess you can think of it sort of like Excel, like you have rows and columns, and Excel focuses on that, and so kind of awk kind of focuses on manipulating things per column. So what I mean is, like, if you do awk, so the syntax is awk apostrophe brackets, and let's say you want to print the first column on this example file, you would do what I just did, and then $1 for the first column. And then you end it, and then the file name. And now we just printed the first column of this file. So obviously, like what this means is like you could have like more math stuff going on here to actually manipulate this column even more. Like if you had numbers instead of letters, like it would make more sense in that way. You could also include other columns if you just add a comma and then number two for like the second column. So then it's outputted there. So that's a useful thing to know about awk. It's more useful for numbers, I guess, when you're manipulating data, because then you can just like aggregate the data. Like if you're just focusing on one column, you would just do some math on that one column and then output it to something else. Okay, so speaking of like outputting, like as Hui was talking about earlier about piping, piping is what's called, it's a way to output the command, output of a command to another command by using what's called a pipe, which is the, I'm not sure what it's exactly called, but it's like next to the brackets on your keyboard. It's like an actual pipe. So this pipe allows you to, if you put it with between two commands, the first command will give its output instead of to the terminal to the other command, so the other command can use it. So an example is like the who command tells you who's currently online. I guess right now for Athena, so all these users are currently on our Athena server. But let's say like we don't really care about knowing like the dates of when they first logged in, or like their IP address, or like all this other stuff. We can just do who pipe, and then using awk this time. Awk. Oops. I forgot print. So now we just have a clean, simple column without all this other extra stuff by piping the output of who to this awk. Similarly, another thing to know is called redirecting, which means instead of outputting the output of a command to another command, just output it to a file. So let's say we have our history and we want to like save all this for like later use, which is a common thing to do. Like if you just ran a series of commands and you want to know which one, you want to know those commands that you ran for use later, you would do history greater than, and then use, and then input any file name. So I'll just do like history save.txt. And now if we ls, we can see that history save is right here. And then just like a quick look at it, we can see that it's all the commands that like Anthony has ran in the last few days are here. So it's good to know. So that's that. Other things to know in general when it comes to like moving around the terminal are what are called key bindings. So key bindings allow you to just use your keyboard to like move around faster. So for example, like yesterday we saw the tab, which you can do like autocomplete stuff. So like less, like as I was doing like even today, like less E just autocompletes the entire file without me having to type it out. So similarly, so that's one key binding. Another key binding is Control A. So if you're at the, so if you finish typing your command but you actually forgot a flag at the beginning, you can just do Control A and your cursor jumps to the beginning. And similarly, if you want to jump to the end, you just do Control E and you're back to the end. Another useful one is Control W, which is like, let's say you typed up this file but you actually want to do it, you actually mistyped and you want to change the name of the file to something else, you would do Control W and it deletes the entire file name, which is like sort of similar to the Control Backspace when you can delete a word and like any other text editor. Other useful ones to know is like Control U. So like let's say you have like this big command and you want to just delete it entirely, you just Control U and then it deletes the whole line. So yeah, there's many more key bindings. If you're really interested, I would suggest like looking some up, because these can really save you a lot of time in the long run. So yeah, I think we can move on to Anthony. Oh, actually, are there any questions?
Thank you, Javier. So a couple other things I want to talk about. So one is file permissions. And so this is less of an issue on your own machine and more on servers. And so we talked a little bit about this executable bit of a program. where you can only execute files if this executable bit is set. But there's a few other bits that give information about file permissions. And so we said ls will show all the files in your current folder. And we said there's some flags that you can add to ls. And so, for example, ls-l gives you additional information. And some of this information is like, what time was this file last created or modified? But then there's all these extra letters at the beginning. And so I want to talk a little bit about what some of these letters mean. And so the first letter is a D if the thing is a directory, and a dash if it's an ordinary file. And so this is useful in cases where like you don't have colors in your terminal. It'll tell you, OK, all the directories are 1 through 5, and then these large and small folders. But then you see these letters R, W, and X. And so R means you have read access to the file, and so you can open it. W means you have write access, and so you can edit it. And then X means you have execute access. And so it's a little bit weird that folders have X, because for a folder, execute access means you can list the contents of the folder. And for a file, execute means that you can run it as a script, or as some sort of program. And so we can see that, for example, this is a text file, and so I can read and write it, but I can't execute it, because what does it mean to execute a text file? And then there's a couple other sets of permissions here. So the first three bits are for me personally. Can I read my own file? Well, I better be able to read my own file. And then we have the permissions of the group that you're in, that this file belongs to. These are rarely used. And then we have three permissions for global access. And so global access is other users on the server can read and write it. And so in general, Athena is a little bit different from other servers. But on large servers, you typically want to not give people write access to your files. And you only want to give them read access if you're comfortable sharing these files. And so these are files that like these are files that are in a public folder that I'm kind of serving to the community. And so I'm fine if you say access Hamlet, because Hamlet's public domain anyway. But if Hamlet were some proprietary information that I were trying to safeguard, I would not be very happy that it is globally readable on this server. And so you can change this with chmod the same way that you can set your own permissions. So we said that chmod plus x is how I make a file executable. And so maybe I have this shell script. I'll talk a little bit about what this is later. But if I want to be able to execute this, I would do chmod plus x and then this fork bomb. And now if I do ls-l, everyone has execution privileges of this file, me and all other users on this server. Sometimes you only want to set privileges for yourself. So suppose I decide that's a mistake. Like, this file looks kind of dangerous. It has the word bomb in it. Maybe I don't actually want people executing it. And so I can remove these permissions with chmod minus x. And now it's no longer executable. I don't know if it's going to let me do this on Athena, but sometimes you can set permissions for just other users and not yourself. Like maybe I don't even want anyone else to be able to read this file, but I want to be able to read it myself. And so I can do chmod O for other users minus R fork bomb.sh. And so now I can still read it, but globally other people can't. And I probably don't want to have them have write access either. So I should do chmod other users minus W. And now if I ls-l, this file is now, other users are not able to read and write it, but I still can. Now, as I said, file permissions are a little bit weird on Athena. just because Athena has a different way of managing files, but on most servers, this would work exactly how I'm describing. Also, as Hui had said earlier, there is a root user on most servers, and they are usually able to read and write everyone's files regardless of what these permissions say. And so if you trust your system administrators, then that's fine. But if you don't trust your system administrators, like these read and write flags are not encryption of any means. They can be circumvented. And so now I want to talk a little bit about copying files to and from servers. And so up until now, we've basically just dealt with what commands I can run if I am logged into the server and I'm using the server as if it were my own computer. Or I can run commands on my own computer that kind of act as itself. But sometimes you want to move files back and forth. And so, for example, on Athena, I have this NumPy wheel. And so the way Python works is wheels are basically offline installers for Python packages. And maybe I want this, or maybe Hamlet. Let's go with Hamlet. Maybe I want Hamlet on my own computer, because I don't want to have to log into the Athena servers every time I want to read Hamlet. I want to read it myself or put it in a Word document or use some other programs that I have on my own computer. So this terminal window is logged into the dial-up, so I'm going to open a second window, and now this is just my own computer. And to access files on servers, or to copy files back and forth, we use this command called scp. And this is secure copy. It's the analog of secure shell, but instead of giving you a shell, which is a terminal session, it gives you a copy. And so if I want to copy a file from a server to my computer, it's the same syntax of copy that you do the thing, the place you're moving from, and then the place you're moving it to. And so I want to copy from athena.dialup.mit.edu, and then I need the path to what I want to copy, which is in the folder public. So this is where pw print working directory is useful, because if I go back to the session that's logged into the dial-up server, I can say, what is the working directory? Okay, I'm in public/intro-terminal/demo-day-2. And then I want hamlet.txt, and I want to copy it to my current directory right here on my computer. And then it's going to prompt me for two-factor. And then I have copied Hamlet. And if I ls in my own directory, I now have this file hamlet.txt. And since this is my own computer, I don't have to even use the terminal if I don't want. I can just navigate inside here and pull this up with a text editor on my own machine. And I could even, if I had Microsoft Word installed, which I don't because this is Linux, but I could view this in whatever editor I want, I'm no longer kind of bound to the terminal. And if for some reason the Athena dial-up servers went down tomorrow, I would still have access to this file. I can also copy in the other direction, like maybe I want to modify Hamlet on my own machine. Let's say I think that Hamlet should actually be Prince of Sweden. And then I can copy back to the server kind of with the opposite syntax. So now I do scp, the file that exists on my computer. And then the name of the server that I want to copy to, and where I want to copy it on the server. So again, public intro terminal day two. So this is the file path on the server where I want Hamlet to go. And again, it asks me for two-factor authentication. No, it didn't like that. Okay. There's some issue with permissions here, sorry. But this is how I would copy back to the terminal, back to the remote server. You can also copy entire folders at once. And so I have this folder of files, a small folder here. And let's just see what's in it. I have 10 text files numbered 1 through 10. And maybe I want all of these on my computer. And so the syntax for copying folders is very similar to copying folders within a computer. You use this dash R flag for recursive. And so if I want the entire folder, I do scp dash R, and I'm copying from the Athena dial-up to my home directory, or my current directory on my laptop. And then it copies the folder itself and all 10 files that were in the folder. And so if I just navigate to this small folder, I can see that all of these files are present. Now, with copying files, like the speed at which you copy depends on, or the time it takes to copy a file depends on the size of the file, but then there's some amount of overhead that's just per file. And so if I copy 10 files, this is fine, but suppose I want to copy 10,000 files. This is going to be a lot of overhead just to kind of open and close the connection to print out all 10,000 of these files that it's copying separately. And that's going to take a while. And so I have this large folder on Athena that I want to copy. And so I don't want to just run ls here because that's going to completely overwhelm things. And so I'm going to use this less command that we've talked about just to see what's in here. So if I do ls pipe to less, it's going to take all the contents of the folder and then move it to this less thing, which is basically a viewer. And so I can see that I have files that go up to 10,000 in this folder. And so I don't want to just blindly secure copy the entire folder. So what I want to do is create something that's called a tarball. And so this is the equivalent of a zipped folder on Windows. Yes?
We have a question. What is the difference between a group and a global?
Okay. So groups are something that are, I would say, rarely used. So in general, you care about your permissions and global permissions, and then there's this group thing in the middle. Groups are primarily used if you have a server that's shared with a lot of people, and then you have like a small collaboration within this larger group. And so maybe on like the Athena dial-ups, I don't want to share a file with the entire MIT community, but I want to share it with you two because the three of us are working together on this project. And so this is a bit beyond the scope of this course, but I could create a group that just has the three of us and share the file among us. Good question. Okay, so if I want to copy a large folder, I need to create basically a zipped file, or the Linux equivalent of a zipped file, which is a tarball. Tar is short for tape archive, because this was used back in the day when storage was done on magnetic tapes. And so what I want to do is, first I have to create a tarball that contains this large folder. And so the syntax to create a tarball is tar dash create, V for verbose, prints out more information, and then F for name of the file you want to create. And I'm going to call it large folder. And the standard extension for tarballs is .tar.gz. This is a bit of a strange extension, but this is what's normally used. And then the folder that I want to put inside this tarball. Oh, no. Okay, so I think this printed out some... Okay. So now I have this tarball that's created here on Athena, and now I want to... I'm sorry. This is the wrong command. CZF, not V, Z. Okay, so now I have this tarball that's created, tarballs are in red, which is a different color than I think we've seen before for LS. It's kind of special for these archive files. And now I can treat this as a single file and just copy that to my computer. So I can do scp athena.dialup.mit.edu. I don't need the dash r flag because I'm copying one file now. And then the path to it, and I call it largefolder.tar.gz, and I want to copy it here. And now that it's on my computer, I can basically do the opposite process where I untar the file with the same command, except instead of C for create, I use X for extract. So XZF, and then the name of the tarball I want to open. And it will now create this folder, a large folder that has all the files that we had originally. All the 10,000 text files. And so that's kind of how you move large files or large folders back and forth. Just a kind of a caveat, the Wi-Fi at MIT is much slower than the Ethernet connection. And so if you are dealing with very large files, you probably want to be connected to Ethernet because this will go faster than Wi-Fi, like about 20 times faster. Okay, so a couple other things, and I do understand that today is kind of a potpourri session of various things that are terminal related. And so one thing I want to mention is background jobs. And so most scripts you can kind of only run one at a time. Like I run a script, it runs to completion, and then we move on to the next script. And in the meantime, I can't do anything with my terminal because my script is running. But there are some scripts that just take a long time to run, like, for example, this long script. So this long script is going to print out all the numbers from 1 to 1,000 at a rate of 1 per second. And so if I just run it, now my terminal will be tied up for the next 20 minutes. And this is probably not very interesting to watch. So you can always kill a process that's, or not always, almost always kill a process that's running with Control-C, which is just the interrupt command. And that will stop things from running. But you can also run things in the background. And so, for example, this sometimes is bad because it will clog up your terminal with a bunch of things, but you can, at least in principle, do other things while this is running. And the way you run things in the background is you put an ampersand after the command. And so I'm going to show this with the command sleep, which is a very boring command. It just does nothing and sleeps for however much time you give it. And so if I say sleep 10, then my computer is going to just wait for 10 seconds before it gives me my terminal back. But if I do, if I run this in the background with an ampersand, now it will start a process in the background that's going to sleep for 10 seconds. But I can still do other things with my terminal while I'm waiting for this process to finish. And then when the process finishes 10 seconds later, it will tell me that this background job that I created is done. And so the way you run jobs in the background is by putting an ampersand after them. One word to the wise, or a couple words to the wise, is that they will still print output. And so if I try to run this long script in the background, like, I do have my terminal back, but every second, it's printing out some random number. And that's going to make it very hard for me to actually use my terminal. And so I can, so I can run jobs to see what jobs are running, and I can kill jobs with the command kill. So the way I do it is I kill, so jobs will give me this list of running processes that are numbered based on when you started them, and then you can kill a certain process with kill percent and then the number of the job that's listed in jobs. You can also, so another thing, we talked about for loops. You can spawn a lot of background jobs at once, which is useful if you have to do it, because especially nowadays, computers are multi-threaded and can handle multiple processes at once. And so maybe I want to run like 10 sleep processes at once. So I could say for I in sequence 1 through 10, so we said this is a for loop that's going to run something 10 times. I can do sleep 10, or let's do a 5-second sleep. And so if I run jobs, now I have 10 jobs, and they're all just doing nothing for 5 seconds. And they all run in parallel, and so I don't have to wait 50 seconds, I only have to wait 5 until they're all done. If you want to wait for all jobs to finish, you can use the wait command. And so if I spawn these jobs and then I type wait, it will just wait until all these 10 jobs are done, and then I get my terminal back. And this is useful if you like, if you want to make sure that all of your processes finish before you use like the output of all of them, but you want to run 10 things at once so you generate 10 times as much output. Sometimes you want jobs to run like and continue running after you log out of the server. And this is useful if you have, say, like a Python script that does some data analysis and has to run, let's just say, overnight. This is a thing that and there are kind of background jobs you might want to just sit there for a while. Like maybe you want to set up a web server or something, and that should be up 24/7. And I don't, for example, the Athena dial-up servers are up 24/7, but I might not want my laptop to be on because I might want to turn it off at night. Or I might want to move to another building, and then that interrupts the Wi-Fi connection or something, and so I'm not still logged into the server. And so, in general, if I start a script running, like this long script, and then I were to close the terminal connection, this job would die. Jobs are, by default, killed when you exit a terminal session, even if they're running in the background. And so one way that you can get around this is a command called nohup. And nohup means no hangup. And so this means that if I leave the session, the job will continue running even with me gone. So if I do nohup longscript.sh, and I always want to make it a background process anyway, even if I'm using nohup, it will tell me that it's appending the output to a file called nohup.out. And so if I cat this file, this is how much of it's run already. And this file, nohup.out, is just going to keep collecting the output of this script that I started running. And this will continue even if I log out of the server. So just to show you, right now this file has 26 lines. I'm going to log out of the dial-up server. And then I want to, maybe I'm going to move my computer someplace else. Now I don't need internet right now. And then however much time later, I'm going to log back into the server. I apologize that I have to do two-factor every time I log in here. And if I now return to the folder where I was, this file nohup.out continues to grow and grow and grow, and it's continued running even after I've logged out and logged back in. There's another way to keep commands running in the background that's useful if you want to interact with them. And so this script kind of just runs and runs, and I don't have to feed anything in or out of it. But maybe like I had some Python code where I wanted to run a few Python commands and then let it run for a few hours. And so there's something called tmux that basically gives you a persistent terminal session that persists across login and logout. And so you can open it with tmux. And then this looks like an ordinary terminal. And so, for example, I could start a Python session here. And then, whoops. And then maybe I just want to go back to this Python code some other day and have this, let's just pretend that this is running some very long Python script, and I want to log out and log back in. So tmux lets you detach your window. And so I can detach a window in tmux by doing control B and then D. And note that I'm not holding down control when I do D. It's just I hold control when I type B, and then I release it and press D. And this says my tmux session is detached. And now if I exit, and then I log back in, one tricky thing with the Athena dial-up servers is you have to log back into the exact same dial-up that you logged into before for tmux to work. Now, if I log back in the next day, my tmux session is still there and still running, and I can reattach it with tmux A for attach. And if I had any code that was actually running and using compute cycles inside here, it would just keep running. And so one thing that you can use this for is, as I said, I have a web server on my desk. It's just a Raspberry Pi. Whoops. And it's not letting me log into it. Whoops. And I have this tmux that's just constantly running, and I can interact with it. I can kill the process. I can restart the web server. I can do whatever I want, and it will just keep running and running in the background. And this is useful because my laptop is not on 24/7, but this Raspberry Pi is. I'll deal with this later. And you can quit out of a tmux session by just using exit the same way you do on any normal terminal session. The last thing I want to talk about is how to use graphics on how to use graphics on terminals. And so we've kind of told you so far that you don't get graphics when you're SSH'd into a system, because you're supposed to use this command line instead of a graphical user interface. But there's a few times when you do really need to run some program with a graphical interface, like, for example, if you're creating plots or something that you really can't see during the terminal. And so, for example, on my research server that I connect to for physics experiments, I have a program called R, which is statistical modeling software. And sometimes this produces plots. And so the way you connect to a server and see graphics on it is when you SSH, you use a flag called dash X. And so this X means forward graphics. And it's called X because the graphics manager on Ubuntu is called the X windowing system. And my research server's name is Wombat. And so now if I log into it, so R is statistics software, and I can create a plot. Let's just say I want to plot 1 through 4. And now this is going to create a window that shows up. So it's going to create a window that then is forwarded to my own laptop. And so I can actually see the plot that I'm creating. And this is quite useful because, for example, I might have data sets on this server that are very large and hard to copy back and forth, or I might just need to do some computations that are much more expensive than my laptop can handle, but a server would be better for. And this allows you to visualize the output. Now, graphics are a little bit finicky, and not all servers will support this, but on ones that do, this is how you work around the fact that you normally only get this command line, and you can't plot things in a command line interface. Okay, so I think we finished a little bit early. So are there any questions on anything that any of the three of us have gone over. Yeah.
Actually, one question was, we talked about exiting the debug.
Right.
Does that end the permanent session that's always there, or does it still run?
Yes. So when you type exit at the end of tmux, that will end the session. If you want it to persist, instead of exiting, you detach it with this control B and then D command.
Yeah, thank
you. Okay, and are there any questions from Zoom? Okay, well, I guess we don't have any exercises for today, but thank you guys for attending, and we hope that you enjoyed this, and we hope that you learned something. And these are our email addresses if you have any questions. SIPI is MIT's Computer Club, and they're also happy to answer questions about computing in general. And we're going to post our slides online afterwards, and we'll post these lecture videos.